They may be our closest relatives, but you have to go a long, long way to see them. It's taken us 6 days to get this far, a remote speck in the middle of Africa. We've been promised the wild bonobos will be worth every bone-shaking moment. Now, one of the reasons people are coming all this way is to answer the really big questions, like, why are we the way we are? Would the world be better if it were run by women? Even, why are we so obsessed with sex? Now, some clues to those answers are right now swinging from tree to tree, not 100 kilometres from here. We just have to get there. And that's not easy. There are just two clapped-out cars in this entire region. Fixing a tyre means melting rubber for a makeshift patch. This part of the Congo hasn't just been neglected by the government, it's been utterly abandoned. There's no electricity or running water, let alone decent roads or bridges. And did I mention the tyres?
Our second flat tire in 10 minutes. Looking like our chances of getting there before sunset.
Not surprisingly, people here don't get many visitors. When they do, it's cause for celebration. They don't mean my name, they're singing about two remarkable conservationists, Sally Cox from the United States and Albert Lokasola from the Congo. They've devoted their lives to helping both the bonobos and the people who live among them.
Three flat tyres at the end.
Are you kidding?
No, we're running out of tyres.
At 3 a.m. we start the final leg of our journey, a grueling walk into the rainforest.
Let's go. Go, Kenda. Mm.
Every day, the trackers follow bonobos till they make their night nests. We have to reach them by dawn before they move again. We make it just in time.
When both this group are watching over here,
yeah.
They heard them vocalize over there.
Yeah.
Starts moving.
Why?
But isn't it amazing how gracefully they move?
No.
It's like almost a dance.
Why
they navigate.
So you don't get blasé about this?
Not at all. Not at all. They're not scared at all, as you can see. They're really interested in us. These same trackers have been tracking them for several years now. They're like family.
It's like they come out.
Okay. They're calling.
Okay, let's go.
This way.
Bonobos are only found in the Democratic Republic of Congo, and they're the least known of the four species of great apes. Scientists have been studying gorillas, chimpanzees, and orangutans for more than a century. But they've only been following these apes since the 1970s, and for much of that time, the whole region's been closed by war. It's a rare and special experience to be this close in the wild. And at times, rather moist.
You just got peed on.
Bonobo pee.
Okay. It's great for the hair.
They look similar to chimps, and it's thought we all share a common ancestor. But bonobos have gone down a very different evolutionary path, raising fundamental questions about our own behaviour.
Bonobos have squabbles, but they don't kill each other the way chimpanzees do. You know, chimps literally wage wars against other troops of chimps over territory, which is what is happening in this country with the war. But bonobos don't do that. They may have squabbles, but then they make up pretty quick.
And they're run by females.
Mm-hmm. And what does that tell you?
Almost uniquely in the animal kingdom, the males remain with their mothers for their entire lives. It's the adolescent females who leave and join new groups, attaching themselves to a dominant female.
So how do you tell a female?
Females have big pink swellers.
What?
Which is their genitalia. That's basically a bonobo vagina.
What?
And it's big. It's like a bullseye.
Mm-hmm.
And the males, you know, the males are males.
And what's really getting people's attention is that they make love, not war.
It's a way of bonding. And, of course, they have sex in all flavours. And it's just part of their life.
So they really are the hippies of the jungle?
They certainly are.
To see just how frisky they are, you have to go to the main place they're being studied, a bonobo sanctuary on the other side of Congo, just outside the capital, Kinshasa. You can barely point a camera here without capturing their favourite pastime. One of the most common forms of sex is female to female. It's a way of forming power alliances, because in bonobo world, it's girls on top.
Bonobo society, it's a ranking female who's dominant, and she has her coterie of other females, and it's usually the son of the ranking female who is the highest ranking male. They have a peaceful, cooperative society. They're the only primate other than humans that has sex, not just for procreation, and they're bisexual. Some scientists say they're pansexual because they really have sex in every way, shape, and form possible. But that's really the polar opposite of chimps, which are our other closest relative. Chimps have a male-dominated patriarchal society. So in that way, bonobos and chimps are sort of like the yin and yang of human nature.
And that's where we get to the big questions about us. Why are people sometimes sharing and loving like bonobos, and sometimes selfish and violent like chimps? A clue may lie in the bonobos themselves. Unlike other apes, they've never had to fight for survival. While gorillas and chimps developed on the north of the Congo River, bonobos have had the south bank all to themselves.
So, chimps and bonobos are never in the same region. Dr. Richard Wrangham of Harvard wrote a book called Demonic Males about chimps, and he postulates that the reason why chimpanzees are more competitive and territorial is because they've had to compete with gorillas over terrestrial herbaceous vegetation, the salad of the forest that apes eat, and bonobos have had no competition for these foods. So that's his theory as to why bonobos are more peaceful and cooperative and share food with each other as opposed to fighting over it.
The terrible irony is that the human world they're living in couldn't be more different. People have been fighting here ever since Europeans came sailing up the Congo, and it's all been over resources. First, it was slaves, ivory, and rubber, and in recent years, whole armies have fought over valuable minerals. Albert Lokasola spent his childhood hiding in the jungle from marauding soldiers. He fell in love with nature and founded a conservation group called Vie Sauvage.
My intention was to save the wildlife, to save the forest, and to help the people, because all are living together.
Oh, mama, you know, Yari. 5 years ago, he joined forces with Sally Cox's group, the Bonobo Conservation Initiative. She'd become fascinated by the apes while working for National Geographic magazine.
Bilamba, Izali.
I really found my holy grail, my personal calling, back in 1993, thinking that I would write about bonobos and try to help them that way and help conservation that way. But what I found was there was practically nothing being done for conservation. And one thing led to another.
They both believe the key to helping animals is to help the people. So instead of fighting over the forest, they look after it.
You can't do one without the other. The conservation problem is a people problem. People are the threat to the forest. People are the threat to bonobos. And if we don't take care of the people at the same time, we're not going to be taking care of the forest and the bonobos. That's why our model is to work with the people to try to build up their standard of living bit by bit and to involve them in the project so that the project really benefits them and provides them with a sustainable sources of income in the future.
They won the community's support to turn the forest into a protected zone. In return, they've helped bring in microcredit projects, better schools and healthcare. Dozens of locals have been employed as rangers.
They're fantastic. The trackers here are doing an amazing job. This is our team leader here, and he was saying that they take care of the bonobos, and they love the bonobos, and they're like members of the family, that they are used to each other, and they come every day, and they really love them. And of course, in their tradition, in their society, the Mongondo people traditionally have protected bonobos for generations.
But here's the problem. Decades of war and poverty are straining those traditional bonds, forcing people to plunder their environment. Selling meat from wild animals has become essential for survival. Albert Lokasola took us to the local market to see some shocking images. Even here, wild primates are being killed for meat and the orphans sold as pets.
This species is called Lophosebus ateremus, black mangabe. Its status now in the forest is calling for attention. It's becoming very rare. A monkey like this will cost $20 for pet, $10 for food. If you get it alive, then you pay more. And this is a monkey.
That's a monkey in there.
This is a monkey.
Right, okay. But no bonobos.
No bonobos yet.
Right, right. So that's been some progress you've brought on.
Exactly.
The problem is even greater in big cities like Kisangani, where rows and rows of smoked monkey meat are openly on sale. Though our cameras aren't especially welcome.
Okay.
Poaching wildlife has become one of the biggest trades in Africa, particularly along the Congo River. These days, about the only way of getting around is dugout canoes. The commercial steamers of colonial times have all but disappeared, along with the coffee plantations that once brought money to remote communities.
The biggest threats to bonobos are hunting for bushmeat and logging, habitat destruction. Because the infrastructure is broken down so much here in the Congo, basically, the only way for people to make money is to kill an animal and sell it, smoke it, take it to market and sell it. So it's really impossible to tell people not to hunt at all.
If you want to tell people anything here, you do it the old-fashioned way. There are no mobile phones, so villagers rely on drums to communicate.
So the talking drum is telling to people that we are on our way to Yalokole Station. So they are saying, Bosongo Tom Bembele,
meaning that you, white people, Dembele, are coming.
Okay.
Are coming with Albert.
We're heading to the village where the project's most ambitious development is taking place, a new health clinic. Hitching a ride with us is Véronique de Klerk, a Belgian midwife who's come to check on the clinic's progress.
Just to get basic drugs here is an extraordinary challenge. To get out of the place when you're sincerely sick, there's no possibility for poor people to do that.
Getting a clinic was the main trade-off people demanded for protecting the forest.
You can't just come here and say we're going to save the bonobos. It's not possible. People will not allow you. People will prioritise their health.
Yanakole is the main base for the project, and its people have laid on an unusual welcome. To honour the visitors, the villagers lay down sarong so our feet don't touch the ground. It's a little overwhelming as it goes on for almost half a kilometre. This is Albert Lokasola's home village, and they're showing their hometown support. It took 3 years of often fraught negotiations with the local community to get protection zoning for the forest. Here, people seem happy with the trade-off.
Biso tolingi mosala ya conservation mingi mingi penza. Papa Albert, Mama Sally, na delegation nyoso bolanda mikanda to maloba ya banguna te. Eloko nyoso ya malamu ezanga kabitumbate. Bobanga eloko te, bokene na projet kaka liboso, biso tozali sima na bino.
So merci beaucoup. Ah,
yeah. Oh, c'est de la voiture.
The clinic has been built through the Australian aid group, the Indigo Foundation.
Ah, c'est la clinique?
C'est la clinique, oui.
Most of the money has come from New South Wales barristers after two visited here 4 years ago.
Ce n'est pas grand chose, mais nous avons déjà opéré ici 171 malades.
171.
Avec trois décès seulement.
It doesn't look much by Western standards, but it can make all the difference in an area that until recently had nothing.
I think with the little means that they have, they've been doing an extraordinary job. This is a very difficult context. You can only fly in, there's no roads. There's one car in a radius of 500-600 kilometres. So knowing that, I think they've been really managing. But there's still a long way to go. What they're doing today in terms of surgery is trying to save a life, because the other alternative is death. That's it.
Ça, c'est notre pharmacie.
And the need is enormous. The clinic struggles to keep up with the endless demand for medicine.
We are like a hub, and people coming. And most of the time, we are overwhelmed. The demand is very high.
So you're stretched very thin trying to do
it all. Very, very thin.
Unless it gets even more help, children will continue to die needlessly.
We don't have the treatment for the more complicated diseases. So the child like this morning is very likely to die, knowing very well that if we would have the means to take it to a proper hospital or a Western type of hospital with good diagnostics, it would have a very good chance of surviving.
So it's still heartbreaking, isn't it?
It is heartbreaking, but it's the reality, I'm afraid, and it's the reality in the majority of sub-Saharan Africa, not only here.
And bringing something to an area that's had nothing can be a risky business. Many people walk for days from other villages to come here. While most are grateful for what the project's doing, some are resentful. Because every time one village gets help, another gets jealous.
This is a daily, daily problem. The benefit sharing and the power sharing, because resources are so, so limited and the needs are extremely high and people are not always patient. So this is really a daily challenge we experience here.
And that's your job, to sort all that out.
And that's my job.
But Sally Cox is determined to keep on going, slowly winning the people's confidence that everyone will benefit.
I started this thing and I can't quit. I can't quit. It's really a life's work. And I hope that we put ourselves out of a job eventually. You know, if what we're trying to do really works, then eventually the Congolese will be able to do this work themselves. And that's really what we're working toward.
And she's not alone in her dream. Outside Kinshasa, the Lola Ya Bonobo Sanctuary has been protecting orphans for 8 years, even when the war spread right to the capital.
Yes, this is Masisi, our little terror, who's about 5 years old.
Gladys Shawland is one of scores of dedicated carers.
I think a lot of people take them in as pets, and then it's the typical story of, you know, they're very cute and attaching when they're little, but even these six-year-olds are as strong as a grown human man. So having that inside the house is a bit destructive.
This is where scientists have done some of the most important studies, though it's no easy task.
And what's he doing?
Grooming.
Okay.
Bonobos have shown themselves to be incredibly intelligent and curious, preferring to study us than let us study them, as our cameraman Ron Eckel found.
What do you reckon, I'm clean?
The sanctuary has just started the difficult process of releasing adult bonobos back into the wild. But it's a fraught aim in a world still dominated by human violence.
Obviously, they know humans, and up until a certain age, they've only known humans who have been good to them and nice to them. So then they're not necessarily afraid. They can't tell who's a hunter and who's not. So I guess the fear is that they won't be safe in the wild. But I think it's the logical next step after a sanctuary, because building up a population in captivity is not where they're supposed to be either.
The bonobos' long-term survival may depend on helping people become the forest guardians. In these strange and little-known apes, Sally Cox sees a symbol of what humanity could be.
We certainly would do well to emulate some of their qualities, especially at this time in our own cultural evolution on the planet. We would be well to learn how to share our resources and cooperate and find a way to coexist without fighting with one another over those natural resources. I think that's the great example bonobos have to show us.